It seems as if there is always someone saying they know when the world is going to end. And they're always wrong. Jesus said no one knows the date or the hour, but he did give us some signs. What are those signs and what do they mean? Today we will take a fresh look at these issues. Welcome to an interactive and live study of the Word of God and the life of Jesus. Cross Connection is about us studying together. And if you're watching us live, you can join our discussion now by sending in your comments, or you can join our ongoing conversation on Facebook anytime, anywhere. Sergio, I'm always excited about our question of the day. Well, so what is our question today?
Well, wars. Rumors of wars, famines, earthquakes, we hear all the time about how these are the signs that we are living in the end times, that Jesus is coming soon. But wait a minute, we've been having wars and famines and earthquakes throughout all of human history. Jesus said that no one knows the day or the hour except the Father. With that in mind, we'd like to ask you this question. What's the purpose behind end time signs, and should it affect how we live our lives?
I'm looking forward to the answers to this question. So please join our discussion on Facebook or Twitter, or you can always text us. One of the most discussed segments of Jesus' life appears in Matthew chapter 24. In this chapter, Jesus outlines events that will precede his second coming. In fact, people often relate this passage to the last day events. How many times have you heard people stating that wars, famines, fatal diseases, and earthquakes are the signs of Jesus' soon coming? Look at today's world. It cannot bear any of these sufferings and turmoils anymore. But were not famines, fatal diseases, and earthquakes happening before as well? Or is it characteristics only of our times now, today? Those who point to these things as the signs of Jesus' soon coming are quoting Matthew chapter 24, verse 7. But if you read the following verse, verse 8, it actually says, all these are just the beginning of sorrows. You see, wars, famines, fatal diseases, and earthquakes were always present on earth. However, does this mean that those who state that these events are the end of the times, wrong? Well, I invite you to take a closer look at Jesus' apocalyptic prophecy with us today. And we are joined today by Ritesh, Alvaro, and all of you. So thanks for joining us.
Thank you for having us.
Okay, so what was the weather today?
It's getting chilly.
It's getting chilly, okay. And today's prophecy and today's study, I believe that it will make us warm, it will make us feel warm.
All right.
Because
yes.
Even in that prophecy, that seems very dramatic. Mm. It does seem dramatic. But even in that passage that we will be reading and we will be discussing, we will find a great hope. So if you are prepared to find that great hope, let's start. And before we start, let's start with the prayer. Sergio, if you could pray.
Sure. Father, as we dig into your word, we ask for your presence. We ask that you open our hearts, you open our eyes, that we may see you in the text that we're about to read. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Okay, we cannot waste any time.
Let's not do it. Let's go.
Let's just do it. Yeah. Okay, and we will start with Matthew. So we are in Matthew chapter 24.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
However, it is very important for us to understand that there is no such thing as text without a context.
Mm.
Because this is our motto of our show.
Yeah.
Whenever we study the Bible, we study it in the context. Mm. If we study the Bible without a context, it's not a Bible study.
Yeah.
So, taking into consideration that we are in this chapter, where was Jesus before in chapter 23 and 22? What was the location where he was? We read about
Yeah, it's been a while. It's been 2 weeks.
It's been 2 weeks.
To Sandy, yeah.
Exactly, yeah. So you completely forgot where we are now.
No, he's in Jerusalem.
Exactly, yeah. He's in Jerusalem first. He's definitely in Jerusalem. In fact, in previous chapters, he was in the temple.
Yes.
Or in the temple, not in the sanctuary itself, but in the temple, in the court of the temple. So now, Jesus does something different, and we'll see what he does. And Jitesh, if you could read for us Matthew chapter 24, verses 1 through 3.
Sure. Then Jesus went out and departed from the temple, and his disciples came up to show him the buildings of the temple. And Jesus said to them, "Do you not see all these things? Assuredly, I say to you, not one stone shall be left here upon another that shall not be thrown down."
Verse 3.
Now, as he sat on the Mount of Olives, the disciples came to him privately, saying, "Tell us, when will we see these things be? And what will be the sign of your coming and the end of the age?"
Okay, so what do you see in this tiny little passage in three verses? First.
It's frightening. I mean, the temple was the marvel of the Jewish people. It was the marvel of the disciples. And to tell them that it was going to be destroyed completely, that there would not be stone over stone, I mean, the reaction of the disciples was like fear.
Okay, so they walked outside, they showed him the temple. Mm-hmm. The temple was so
impressive. Like,
yeah, it
magnificent.
Was magnificent. It was the only building of that time that was just as big.
Yeah.
In fact, this is very important now. I want you to understand this very clear, and I want you to understand this as well, because this is something that my wife found simply amazing.
Okay.
Before all her years, she thought that the Wailing Wall of the temple, it is the wall of the temple. It was the wall of the temple. Yeah. However, it is not. What usually people think about the Wailing Wall in Jerusalem, where people come and pray, it's just a retaining wall. What is a retaining wall?
Maintain like the mountain.
Okay.
Temple.
Yeah. So just imagine that this is the mountain.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
This is the mountain. When the temple was rebuilt, Herod decided to, because the temple, he wanted to build a temple that would be even bigger than the mountain itself. So what did he have to do
expand the base?
Exactly. In order to expand the base, you need to put more soil.
Mm-hmm.
But in order to support soil, you need to build concrete walls. So he built those concrete walls around the mountain so that the mountain can be expanded.
Mm.
So that on that platform he could build the temple, which would be so enormous that bigger than the mountain itself.
Mm.
Now, this is something simply amazing. What is that prophecy that Jesus says in Matthew chapter 24, verse 2? When disciples show him the temple?
Not one stone here will be left on another. Everyone will be thrown down of the huge temple.
Okay, so what was it? Not even one stone will be left on another. In other words, there will be just a football field. Nothing else. And Sergio probably can testify because you like sports.
Sure, yeah.
So it will be just that grand...
A football field, but with no field goal posts.
Yeah, exactly.
No,
just flat.
Completely flat.
Just flat. I wonder, did it really happen or not?
There's nothing right now. I mean, literally, it's just only the Weeping Wall. That's the only place that's left of the temple.
Exactly.
That's not even the temple.
Yeah, so it's the Wailing Wall. Right now there are structures on that place right now.
It's a different mosque.
Yes, but in 70 AD, and this is what we need to do, Titus, General Titus, and I would like us to see this picture because the Titus, when Titus came and general, he was general at that time.
Mm-hmm.
When he approached, and you can see this picture behind me. When he approached Jerusalem, he actually sieged Jerusalem, the city, yes. And he destroyed his warriors, they completely destroyed the temple.
Mm.
Okay, so what do you see about this prophecy? So it was fulfilled.
Yeah, and it's interesting that, you know, again, in the context, Jesus has entered Jerusalem. He overturns the temple, completely, you know, overturning everything they had. He rails against, for a whole chapter, the leaders of the temple. And then as they're leaving, he goes, oh, by the way, that's going to be completely torn down.
Completely destroyed.
And this is absolutely crucial.
Yeah.
Because the context, remember, Jesus constantly was reminded and constantly was trying to make it clear that I want you to repent. I want you to repent, please. I even come to the temple. I've tried to clean the temple, cleanse the temple.
Yeah.
In the previous chapter, let's just look at the previous chapter, verse 37. And Sergio, what does it say?
O Jerusalem, Jerusalem, the one who kills the prophets and stones those who are sent to her. How often I wanted to gather your children together as a hen gathers her chicks under her wings, but you were not willing. See, your house is left to you desolate. For I say to you, you shall see me no more until you say, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord.
So, and we always associate this verse as Jesus crying over Jerusalem.
Yeah.
So he spent all his years
trying to teach the people to repent, to come back.
Exactly. To turn around.
Yeah, and I think it's really interesting. We look at, okay, he made a, there's a prophecy, he made a prediction, and look, it came true, and that's great. But why did he say that? What's the meaning behind that? And as we've seen in the previous chapters, he comes to this place that is corrupt, a place that represents an in-between between you and God, you know, a place that you have to go to, and then you connect to God. And he completely destroys it and predicts, he predicts its destruction, saying, this is no more. This way of doing things is gone. And basically, your connection to God is direct now.
Yeah.
It's interesting that the Jewish thought that the temple was protected by God. I mean, it was not only an amazing building, it was the temple. I mean, by God established. So they would be protected there. And Jesus stating that, it's long gone. I mean, you're not, or you're looking here, it's gone.
The glory of God is departing from you.
Yeah.
And this is what happens when the glory of God is not with you anymore.
You're just rocks.
You're just rocks.
I mean, it doesn't really matter whatever it is.
And those rocks will be also destroyed.
And even in the destruction, the Jewish people, like in the year 70, the Jewish people refugees themselves inside the temple to get protection. They got burned.
Yeah.
I mean, there was nothing there to help them.
Okay, now coming to the question the disciples ask. Immediately after that, the disciples ask him a few questions. What was the first question that they asked in verse 3 we read about it? Jitesh.
When will these things be?
Okay, when will these things be? Second question.
What will be the sign of your coming?
What will be the sign of your coming? And third question?
And the end of the age.
When will be the end of the age? So those are three main, most important questions. However, the message that we will read following and we will discuss, it's coded. It doesn't seem that Jesus is plainly stating what is going to happen. It seems like he's trying to make it such a mystery.
Yeah. And the questions were pretty straightforward.
Yeah, the questions were straightforward. Why did Jesus...
simple questions?
Yeah,
Jesus,
just, when?
This date.
Yeah. Yeah.
Okay, but we will need to wait. And after the break, we will try to understand why.
Okay.
So be prepared. As we take a break, think about today's question and share your thoughts with us on Facebook especially. What's the purpose behind end time signs and should it affect how we live our lives today? Welcome back to Cross Connections. So we are amazed what was happening with Jesus. What was happening with Jerusalem and with the temple.
And the disciples.
And disciples were like, they were almost envisioning what was happening. And the first reaction was, Jesus, tell us when it's going to happen.
Right.
Because it's such a disaster.
Natural reaction. I mean, that's what you want to know.
And Jesus starts telling them what is going to happen. And let's start, let me ask you a question first. Why do you think, and do you think that the Bible, sometimes it seems like it's encrypted?
It does seem that way, you know? I mean, and especially here, like you were saying, it's three direct questions. When's it going to be? Oh, it'll be in 12 years, and the sign will be this. And, you know, but it's not that. And so makes you wonder why.
But exactly, why?
Yeah.
This is the question that I asked. Yeah.
I was just going to say, why? I was just going to finish in the sentence, but you already said it.
Okay, I guess we could probably continue this discussion on our Facebook page. So why?
Why?
Mm-hmm. Why sometimes we see that God and Jesus, they don't speak it just the way we want it to hear.
Right, right.
Because I don't know, one perspective would say that if it was clearly stated, like, it's this, 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 what's the point of believing? I mean, it's just there. I mean, it's really not good to refute something that's already written. But if you have to go through it, and there's a part that's not that clearly stated, you have to believe. Mm-hmm. I mean, it's a matter of faith. It's a matter of not something that's so clear, but if you believe it, it makes it clear. So it's like going one step more to make it a real thing for you.
Mm. Yeah. But at the same time, remember when disciples approached Jesus and they said, why do you speak in parables?
Yeah.
We always think about parables as something very easy to understand.
Yeah.
However, he said, no, I want you to understand something very important. Mm. What is revealed to you is revealed to you by faith and through faith. Mm. But it's revealed to babes as well.
Yeah.
But from those who know everything, it's hidden.
Yeah.
So sometimes, and again, this is something very important, because when we study the scripture reveals itself. Mm-hmm. And there is such thing as inner biblical interpretation. So the Bible interprets itself. Mm-hmm. So when we study the scripture, it will reveal itself.
But you have to study it.
But we need to study.
It's the same concept that if you only read a couple of verses, you don't get the complete meaning of it. You get the history, you get like lessons for your life, but you don't get the true meaning.
And that is why
you have to go deep. That's an invitation. It's like Jesus picking on you, saying like, go deep, like learn more.
So it's almost as if God is giving you a choice, as he has been doing, is that you need to make the decision to dive deeper, to figure out more. So God is saying, look, I have these things, let's get into it.
Exactly.
Let's learn more.
Yeah, exactly. And that is very important. And if you go even to John chapter 5, verse 39, and John chapter 5, verse 39, there is one line that you probably know, you probably remember. You search the scriptures, for in them you think you have eternal life, and these are they which testify of me. Mm. But the word that is used there, you search the scriptures. Mm. Mm.
Go deep.
What does it mean? What does it mean to you, Jitesh?
To search the scripture.
Yes.
That means to dive deep into it and to really start to apply it into your own life. It's not just reading words. It's what do these words mean to me, and how can I use them in my life?
Okay, excellent. So let's continue. Yeah.
And I think, you know, and what we're talking about, this is the question that we've asked. You know, what is the purpose of this? Why is it encoded? What's the purpose of these signs and trying to decipher them, and what's it all about? And you said you read verse 39, so I'll read verse 40, because I think it kind of, goes to something that we should be thinking of. But you are not willing to come to me that you may have life.
Wow.
And I think anytime we're looking through this, a lot of times, man, I see a lot of prophecy stuff, and it lists a lot of dates, and it lists a lot of events, and I'm not even going to attack the accuracy of that. Mm-hmm. But it's pointless unless we're coming to him and coming to know him that we may have life. And really, Jesus earlier in Matthew praised God that the secrets of his kingdom were hidden from the elect but revealed unto children.
Yes.
It is when you search the scriptures to see Jesus and to see God, then things are revealed to you. The Holy Spirit impresses upon you and reveals so many wonderful things in his word. And I think that's what it's about.
And this is very important. I remember once I heard that somebody said that about 25% of the Bible is the prophecies. Mm. And it's true, but 75% of the Bible testifies about God's love and Jesus.
Yes. Right. So, I mean, also the prophecies testify about the same thing. I mean, to know that God's in control and that he knows every detail means that he doesn't let us to go wander whatever we
want.
It's he's on top of us, in control, loving us.
Exactly. Yeah. And this is what is very important. Okay, let's go to Matthew chapter 24, verses 4 through 14.
Wow.
And Sergio, if you could read for us 10 verses.
Okay, take a deep breath.
Yes.
All right. And Jesus answered and said to them, take heed that no one deceives you, for many will come in my name, saying, I am the Christ, and will deceive many. And you will hear of wars and rumors of wars. See that you are not troubled, for all these things must come to pass, but the end is not yet. For nation will rise against nation, and kingdom against kingdom, and there will be famines, pestilences, and earthquakes in various places. All these are the beginning of sorrows. Then they will deliver you up to tribulation and kill you, and you will be hated by all nations for my name's sake. And then many will be offended, will betray one another, and will hate one another. Then many false prophets will rise up and deceive many. And because lawlessness will abound, the love of many will grow cold. But he who endures to the end shall be saved. And this gospel of the kingdom will be preached in all the world as a witness to all the nations, and then the end will come.
Wow.
Okay. This is a fascinating passage.
Yeah.
That's like the whole world's history in
verses.
Exactly. It's the entire world's history. On the other hand, it's the entire history of that time as well. So it can be applied both to the time of Jesus, when he was talking about it, when he was referring to the destruction of the temple.
Yes.
But at the same time, it can be applied to the entire nations and what was going to happen to the entire world.
Yeah, and I really like the fact that you can look at this on different scales, you know, because like you said, what's being described here, famines, all these things, and then the persecution. I mean, that's talking about just what's going to happen in the next few years for them, the disciples, and the early church. But you can also look at it bigger picture and just the history of the world. And so, to me, it speaks of a bigger issue thing, that bad things happen in the world. They're going to keep happening, and it's listed over and over, but stay strong.
It's that history has a way of repeating itself all the time, but the one who stands firm through the end will be saved.
Yeah. Yes, and it says here clearly, for instance, if you hear about the rumors of the wars, it's not the end in verse 6, no?
Right.
But the end is not yet. Then he continues, you will hear about famines and earthquakes and pestilence, etc., etc. But these are just the beginnings of your sorrows. And then he continues, and then he says about somebody will be delivered and you will be persecuted, but it's not the end either. Mm. What is the end?
And this gospel,
the gospel of the kingdom is preached
in the whole world as a testimony to all nations.
Yeah. Wow. And that is the end.
Yeah.
So he's just saying, you know what, guys, gentlemen, he's probably talking to disciples.
Yeah.
Sometimes you can miss the picture when you emphasize on that part. And forget about the last part. What is supposed to be preached?
The gospel.
What? Is it the prophecies or anything of that nature? No, he says clearly, I want you to preach the gospel, and then the end will come.
Yeah, and it's something that really hit me a lot too, looking at this, because when you're younger and you hear things about prophecies, even about this specific text, you know, I would think of it in terms of endure to the end. Man, you just got to live. You got to make it through these horrible times. Just survive. Cling on to anything. Just make it through. And verse 12 really kind of puts it in a new light for me. It says, and because lawlessness will abound, the love of many will grow cold. And then just shortly after, the gospel needs to be preached to me, it's about don't let your love grow cold. You know, throughout all, you're going to see so much horrible stuff in your life. Anyone in any era, you're going to see all kinds of terrible, horrible, wicked things in your life. Don't let your love grow cold.
Depends on what you're looking for. I mean, I really like the verse 8. Some version says all these are the beginning of birth pains.
Yes. Mm.
When you have a mother, when she's about to deliver, I mean, the pains usually begin like 24 hours before. And she knows when the baby begins moving that it's coming. I mean, she knows like the time. She doesn't know the exact time, but she knows it's close.
Right.
And then the pain increases, just increases. Mm. And when they don't have anesthesia, it just increases a lot. But if they're focused on the pain, they will scream and yell, tell all the curse words. But they're like some mothers focus on their children.
Yes.
I mean, some mothers focus that if they scream, it's harming their children. Mm. So it just focus, I have to get through this. And they all suffer the same pain. Mm. But it's what you focus on. I mean, it's what you get, like you can cling on to make you go through the steps.
Absolutely.
Yeah, I like that.
If you look at this passage, let's just think about how can we advance then the kingdom of heaven practically in our everyday life. Mm. Because it says in verse 14, what does it say? Jitesh, how can you practically say or apply it in your life and advance the kingdom of heaven even?
Well, just listening to what everybody's saying is that it comes down to me is my relationship with Jesus. And the more I dive into learning about his word, the more I learn about his love for me, that gets me through all these things. Because right now the world is not a good place and there's nothing good going on in it. But it is our love from God, our love that we have for God and the love that he has for us that gets us through it all. So in the end, it says, but he who endures will be saved in the end.
Yes, but then he continues, but then the gospel will be preached
to all nations.
What, you know, sometimes we can be in danger if we just hide this scripture and just hide the gospel and just hide it in our hearts and in our churches and anywhere else, but we forget about the second half.
And people, you know, forget the part of preach. Preach doesn't mean get up on the stand and go say something in front of a church and to be a pastor. Sometimes they say that you are the best sermon that someone's ever going to hear. It's just you living your life and you having the love of Jesus and showing it to somebody else. Not judging, forgiving. Those things is how what God wants in the end of times. Is all this destruction is going on and this guy is loving his neighbor.
And this is what we have been discovering in the past. And this is what we will discover in our next study, which is next Tuesday as well. So don't go anywhere. We are just taking a very short break now, and we will be back after a very short break. Don't forget to share your thoughts about today's question. What is the purpose behind end time signs, and should it affect how we live our lives today? We're looking forward to your comments. Let us know what you think, and your comment will be read here in the studio. Welcome back. The study of the words of the Word of God sets our hearts on fire. And if you feel the same, don't keep it to yourself. Would you agree?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Are we on fire? I don't see it. But anyway, yeah, let's do it. Okay. The Great Tribulation, and this is something very significant. So unfortunately, by the end of our discussion, we'll be like, oh, let me add one more thing. So let's just do it now. The Great Tribulation. Immediately after Jesus says the gospel of the kingdom will be preached in all the world as witness, and then the end will come. Immediately after that, Jesus continues, therefore, when you see, and then let's just read verses 15 through 20, and Jitesh, if you could read for us those verses.
Therefore, when you see the abomination of desolation spoken of by Daniel the prophet standing in the holy place, whoever reads, let him understand. Then let those who are in Judea flee to the mountains. Keep going?
To verse 20, yes.
Let him who is on the housetop not go down to take anything out of his house. And let him who is in the field not go back to get his clothes. But woe to those who are pregnant and to those who are nursing babies in those days. And pray that your flight may not be in the winter or on the Sabbath.
Okay. So, yes. Sir, Jitesh?
No. Go ahead.
So in this, as we see right here, Jesus is clearly stating that this is something that will happen to you, disciples, and to you.
Yes.
Yeah.
But
here he also gives us a hint that we definitely need to read the Daniel the prophet. And then he continues in verse 15, whoever reads, let him understand.
Yeah.
So he is stating clearly that you need to study the Word of God.
Yeah.
You definitely need to, and you need to study, and you need to try to understand the Word of God. And once you understand the Word of God, it yields its fruits. So don't shut your eyes. Don't close your eyes.
When you understand it, it saves your life. I mean, it's clearly stating what you have to do to save your life is to study. I mean, to go to Daniel and to know when that the abomination, the cause of desolation, it's on the holy place, then go out. I mean, and like life-saving advices. Same thing for us. I mean, if you want to live, study the Bible.
Yeah,
that's good implication. Basic.
Yeah, look, and again, he's quoting here when Jesus is talking about it. He's talking about Daniel chapter 9 verses 26 and verses 27, which clearly state when Jesus even there is a prediction when Jesus actually was going to come. So think about that. There is a prediction that says that Jesus will come.
Yeah, yes. And you wrote a blog post on it just recently, and it accurately predicts to the year when Jesus is going to come, and then it also predicts this stuff. It's kind of scary.
Exactly.
You know, when you know the first is accurate.
So, yeah, we would like to refer to our blog post. So go to our website, and you'll be able to see something that we discovered there. Because this is, but even in that prophecy, there is a great hope about Jesus, who Jesus really is.
Yeah.
That he brings the deliverance.
Right.
The deliverance, yeah.
Yeah, and just, you know, you look at that passage and it's kind of scary. You know, a lot of bad things are going to happen and really people fleeing and, you know, horrible things happening. So I'll just jump in with a comment that Caitlin had on Facebook referring to our question saying, it should affect our lives because it is preparing us for what will happen. As long as we have faith in our Lord that he is coming to take us to heaven with him, we have nothing to fear. And I think, you know, when you read something, you know, scary, like some of the stuff that's in there, that's the important thing to remember. Keep your eyes on Jesus and know, you know, ultimately you have nothing to fear.
Okay, and then the following verse is actually verse 21. And Alvaro, if you could read for us verse 21, what does it say there?
For then there will be great distress, unequal from the beginning of the world until now, and never to be equal again.
Yeah.
That's pretty discouraging.
Yeah. It actually says, in some Bibles, it says great tribulation.
Yes.
What is tribulation, Jitesh? What is the tribulation?
A very tough time.
Tough time?
Yes.
Do we live in a tough time?
Yes, we do.
Do we?
I mean, we do live in a tough time, but it's, I mean, we can get out of it. It's livable.
But it also says great tribulation, but it says continuing, such has not been since the beginning of the world until this time, no, nor ever shall be. So it's not, maybe we may be in a form of tribulation, but it's very much mild compared to what is to come. So this is something that we've never experienced. Probably we wouldn't even be able to imagine how much it's going to be.
I mean, when you read the stories of the Dark Ages, that period in history where the Christians were persecuted, the physical pain they had to endure, it's just unimaginable. I mean, that's way more than what we could ever have right now.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But some people in some other countries, they still they experience those great tribulations.
Yes, they do.
And in this specific prophecy, Jesus is talking about most likely about he was talking about the Dark Ages. When those Dark Ages there was constantly tribulation, and people were like, when it will come to an end. But even in those days, there was great hope. What is the hope that we can have, and what was that hope that they had?
During the Dark Ages?
During the great tribulations of any times.
It depends on where you have that hope. I mean, it's like whatever bad things happen, if you already know they're gonna happen and you know that there's light at the end of the tunnel, you cling to that hope. I mean, you just get yourself, your mind there. So whatever happens, you just know it's gonna end because something's coming.
Go ahead.
Well, I just think, you know, when you look at, you know, obviously he's talking about tribulation, horrible things happening, whether it's now, whether it's before, you know, really what jumps out to me is the important thing to remember is what he goes into next, you know, talking about the second coming, which is it's going to end. You know,
exactly.
There is a light at the end of the tunnel. It'll all be over.
And then let's read the following verse that Sergio alluded to, and it's verse 27. So what does it say in your Bible?
For as the lightning comes from the east and flashes to the west, so also will the coming of the Son of Man be.
So as you see, there can be tribulation.
Mm.
There can be something else. There can be anything, whatever you can think of, and it will be harder than before.
Mm.
But as the lightning, there will be also the coming of the Son of Man.
I really like that, like verse 22 says that the days will be shortened. I mean, like, it will be bad, but God's grace is on top of you. I mean, God's grace is right there to you. You'll see, like, it will be really, really bad, but he's there. I mean, he is still guiding you.
Yes. For me, I mean, just reading that till the end of the passage, that almost sums up my life in the fact that we go through so much in our lives. There are people saying things back and forth, saying bad things about you, or you're going through a tough time. And God is clearly saying out of this is that you may be going through really tough times and you may not see that there's the hope, but clearly I'm there. I'm on top of it. And my grace is there in all the little things that you may feel are so hard to bear. There is my grace. And I am still, and remember that I'm going to be there at the end. So as soon as you start to focus on the fact that as soon as God shows up, what happened to the problems? It doesn't talk about it afterwards. You're going to know that like lightning, I'm going to show up in your life and I'm going to take care of it. There's nothing else to worry about.
Yeah.
So we need to apply that to our lives now. We don't need to wait till bad things start happening. Bad things are happening now, but God is in control and we have something to look forward to.
Yeah, I really like the mercy, the element that you guys are both highlighting. Because again, so many times, you read through or you see a presentation on this chapter and other prophetic chapters, and it's this dry timeline, you know?
Bad things happen.
Yeah, exactly. But really what you read here is Jesus is saying this not to give a timeline, because we said, why doesn't he just give a timeline? Mm-hmm. You know, why doesn't he just say, it's going to happen here and it's going to happen there and this is going to happen at this time and this is exact thing is going to happen at this exact time? But really, in this context, it's highlighting the mercy of God. Look, bad things are going to happen, not just to one specific group of people. Bad things are going to happen to almost each and every time, each and every person, but there's an end to it. I'm going to shorten it, you know, and there is a light at the end of the tunnel. Like, his mercy is there on the other end of it.
And what is especially fascinating, just previous passage we've just read, mm-hmm. in verse 27, it says, like lightning from the east to the west, like flashes. It's going to be gracious. It's going to be so magnificent. Mm. And then he says, verse 29, immediately after the tribulation of those days, the sun even will be darkened. So it's not just tribulation. Even the sun will be darkened. Even the moon will not give its light. The stars will fall from heaven, and the powers of heavens will be shaken. What else can you expect? But then he continues, Sergio, and we can read about it in verse 30. Yes.
Yeah.
And then the sign of the Son of Man will appear in heaven, and then all the tribes of the earth will mourn, and they will see the Son of Man coming on the clouds of heaven with power and great glory.
Yeah.
That is the sign.
Yeah. And I just want to jump in with a comment from Adelina, because it's talking about exactly what we're talking about right now, where she says, I actually find great mercy in Jesus' response. He does not tell them the time. Instead, he tells them the things that must take place before he returns so that they won't get discouraged while waiting. Mm-hmm. And we know today their waiting was a lifetime waiting. This is just as relevant to me today. The reassurance in this passage is the promise and certainty of his coming. Even while things look very gloomy on this earth, as we experience much suffering and sorrow, we can be reassured that these don't have the final answer. Jesus does.
Amen.
Amen. Adelina, we don't have anything to add to it. So we just need to take a break now.
Yes.
Because after the break, we actually will talk about the day
when
Jesus is coming.
Cool.
Are you excited?
Yeah. Cool.
Okay, we'll try. We will find out the day. And if you have your computer nearby, now is the perfect time to go online and answer our question. What is the purpose behind end-time signs, and should it affect how we live our lives today? We will be back in studio to continue our discussion after a very short break. Welcome back. If you want to join our discussion, just use the all possible means, and especially your Facebook account.
Especially.
And thank you, Adelina, for posting.
Comment. Yeah, I just showed all of your comment. Yeah.
Okay, thank you, Adelina, for posting on Facebook. So it's very exciting because we are coming to a very important part. When Jesus actually says when he will come. He actually says when Jesus will come.
Awesome, yeah. Let's hear it.
And Sergio, I want you to discover when Jesus will come.
I missed that in the first read through.
Okay.
It'll be front page tomorrow.
It will be front
Breaking
page.
Breaking news from Cross Connection.
Yeah.
We know exact day when Jesus will come. It's verses 36 through 44, but we will read 36, through 44.
Okay. You want me to read it? Okay.
Yes.
But of that day and hour, no one knows.
Okay. just
not even the angels of heaven, but my Father only. But as the days of Noah were, so also will be the coming of the Son of Man. For as in the days before the flood, they were eating and drinking, marrying and giving in marriage, until the day that Noah entered the ark, and did not know until the flood came and took them all away. So also will the coming of the Son of Man be. Then two men will be in the field, one will be taken and the other left. Two women will be grinding at the mill, one will be taken and the other left. Watch therefore, for you do not know what hour your Lord is coming. But know this, that if the master of the house had known what hour the thief would come, he would have watched and not allowed his house to be broken into. Therefore you also be ready, for the Son of Man is coming at an hour you do not expect.
Okay, so let's just answer that question. When Jesus will come back?
When things look like the days of Noah?
When? What does it say?
Anytime.
No, what does it say in verse 36?
No one knows.
No one knows.
Yeah.
We don't know when Jesus is going to come.
Yeah, and just, you know, you mentioned how things look, you know, at the days of Noah. And I, as a kid, I was always taught, you know, things are going to be like how they were at the days of Noah. People are going to be eating and drinking. There's going to be, you know, debauchery and, you know, all of these things. And that's when we'll know. But when I read it again, it's all this whole, that whole chunk that we just read, it's all very much just day-to-day things, things that always were and mm-hmm. always have been, mm-hmm. you know. People have been eating and drinking always. People yes. have been marrying and giving in marriage always.
Yes.
You know, and the suddenness and the unexpectedness is what's highlighted here.
Exactly.
Two people are just working. Boom.
One is yeah. one is gone.
All of a sudden, you know, this Jesus comes, you know, yeah. And one was one was ready for him and the other one wasn't.
We have to be very careful because sometimes we even build our theology on the basis of two verses.
Those two verses, right.
Because, one's taking the other.
Because, but there, the context is crucial because in verse 36 it says, but no one knows of the day or the hour. And then in verse 42, it's exactly the same. It says, watch therefore, for you do not know. So yeah. as we see, it's about unexpectedness, and just Sergio highlighted. And in between there is just an example of what it means. You can eat, you can drink,
it's
you can work, anecdotal. You can do whatever. Yeah. You can be with your working on your computer, but then Jesus can come.
Yeah.
It's like looking at another perspective. You can die in any moment. I mean, you close your eyes, and the next thing you open, Jesus is coming. I mean, and literally, you can die while you're working, you're in the handmill. I mean, you could cross the street and not be tragic, but a car could crash you. I mean, that happens all the time.
Yes.
You have no certainty of your life, even though everyone loves to buy life insurance. I mean, you want to keep everything safe, but it's not. I mean, you can lose everything by a hurricane who comes and takes your house.
Yes.
I mean, you can die at any moment.
Yeah.
And that's the uncertainty. You have to be prepared.
But to me, I feel like it's a lot deeper than that. For
okay,
because they're talking about eating and drinking and marrying, and so all this stuff was going on, and is going on, and they had these warnings. But it's saying only when Noah was entering into the boat is when people started to get afraid. So basically, eating, drinking, all this stuff is living your life without making a change. There are signs that you see, there are people saying things to you, but you are continuing to live the same life. And you are not looking for a change or looking to be better or looking to be a better person.
Yeah.
This is simply amazing.
And that's how I would apply it, or how I'm thinking about it now in my own life is how I see these signs. What am I going to do about it?
Yeah.
Exactly. And this is what I want you to...
And I want to jump in because James has a comment on Facebook talking about this exact thing. James says, the purpose of this is to remind us and give us hope that it won't be much longer now. It should affect our lives by giving us a sense of urgency. We should be taking God's message to as many people that will hear it before it's too late.
Wow. Thank you so much, James, for this wonderful comment.
Absolutely.
It sums up everything.
Right.
That's the point. I mean, that's what we were talking. When it says that the gospel will preach to the whole earth, who's going to preach it? I mean, everything seems like natural things.
Be like Noah. Be like Noah. Start building this boat.
Start preaching. I mean, if it takes you 600 years to preach, preach every day, because the gospel has to reach every place, and you're the one who has to preach it.
You're advancing the kingdom.
You have to go to your neighbor or to the half of the earth, but it's you. I mean, you're the one who's taking the gospel. That's the sign of the time.
Yeah. Let me just draw a parallel. What did those people who lived in the time of Noah, what did they have to do in order to be saved?
Get in the ark.
What was it?
Just get in the ark.
Just obeying. I mean, it's common sense. The same thing here. I mean, as it says, don't do it, don't do it. I mean, there's a reason why it says.
Yeah. Okay, now,
I just want to add something about the ark, too, and how it relates to, you know, how it relates to Jesus. Mm-hmm. Because, and how we view salvation. Because Jesus' death on the cross, it did something. You know what I mean? We talk about it like, oh, if and this and that. It did something. It was an ark that was built, so to speak.
It was built, yes.
It's an ark. You just have to get in it. You know what I mean? It's not that, you know, it's something that you have to do. Maybe you have to get on a lifeboat to it or something like that. It's just been built. It's there. Just get in.
Yes.
And to add to that is, did God tell Noah to build a small little boat? Or did he tell him to build something extremely huge?
Yeah.
And how many people were actually in the boat? And why did Noah build it so big? It's because that's how big God's love is for you. He had more than enough space for everybody to get in. So don't think that this is a small thing where only a select few people can join in. Everybody can join in. All you have to do is accept it.
And that is why when he is looking at Jerusalem, he is crying and he's saying, Jerusalem, Jerusalem. I feel this feeling that is called splagnizomai.
Right.
He experiences this ache.
Yeah.
His inner organs are aching. Yeah. And he's just crying out, I want you to be saved.
Yeah. It's like if someone's drowning and you reach the hand and the other one person just doesn't grab you.
Yeah. I mean, this is simply amazing, because so much of Jesus' grace and Jesus' love can be seen through these prophecies.
Yeah.
When Jesus says what he says. Okay, we have only 4 minutes left, okay, and we need to summarize and just conclude our study. And I will ask you the question that I usually ask. What did you learn today? What did you learn today? And Jitesh, tell us, what did you learn today?
Well, the big one I learned is that we don't know when Jesus is coming, but we should expect that it can be at any time. The point is, what are we going to do to apply what we have learned and apply it to our lives to make a difference, to make a change? If you're used to living your life a specific way with the same old habits, how about let's look for a change? Let's see if you can talk to the Lord, spend some time with Him, and see if you can be different. And I assure you that there will be a change. So I'm going to apply that in my own life, in the things that I do routinely. Maybe I can learn to change and be more like Jesus. So
this is excellent. And that is why we study the Gospel according to Matthew, because all the way till chapter 24, Jesus was talking about, remember, the Sermon on the Mount. There was the Sermon on the Mount. There was other teachings. There was parables. There was a lot of parables. There was other teachings of Jesus. There was healing. There was a big chunk of material that we went over. And in all that material, Jesus was trying to make it clear. What do you need to do? You just accept me. Follow me. I want you to be saved. Just follow me. And now he comes and says, I want you to embrace it. Alvaro, what did you learn today?
We used to love chapter 24 because it has a lot of facts about things that are going to happen. And we love being paranoid about stuff. We love watching the news of bad things that happen. But the main focus of this chapter is that we have to stand firm to the end. I mean, it doesn't really matter what's happening around you. You have a purpose. You have a reason to be here. Stand firm. I mean, your reason is to glorify God by being like Jesus. Preach the gospel. Doesn't matter if the whole world is destroying around you. You have a mission to accomplish while you're on the earth.
Because you were created in the image of
God.
God.
Yeah. Stand firm to the end.
Be resemblance of Jesus. Excellent. Yeah, Sergio.
I'll add a comment that Caitlin has on Facebook. She says, I would just like to add, the end times are not meant to make us fearful or to scare us into Jesus' arms. He uses those signs as a reminder for us that He is coming soon. And we need to share His message with everyone around the world so that they may be saved just as we know we are. His great love and mercy is meant to be shared. I'm so thankful to know He's coming soon.
Wow, this is amazing.
Yeah, and it's, you think end time prophecies, it's doomsday, it's horrible things. And something that sticks to me that can be, just in any situation, I think is a lot of times young people, you look at adults and sometimes at older people and you see things that maybe make you disillusioned. I think verse 12 speaks to me strongly. The love of many will grow cold. I think something that sticks with me is make sure your love doesn't grow cold.
Cool.
Through all the hard things that you go through age, through hard times, through persecution, through hypocrisy, through anything, don't let your love grow cold.
Make sure you stand firm.
Yeah. And share it with as many people because he's coming.
Because this love, you're overfilled with this love. Yes. So why don't you share this love? All these signs that we read of, they remind me of another sign that Jesus gave in the time of Noah. After the flood was finished,
the
people saw what?
A rainbow.
The rainbow. Yeah. That rainbow. What was the symbol of that? What was the purpose of that rainbow?
To remind the people of the covenant of God with the people, with humanity.
To remind that nothing will happen again.
Yeah.
These are another signs. Different signs that will constantly remind us of something else, that the glory of God will be restored on earth.
Amen.
And even though we have to go all these tribulations, earthquakes, famines, anything, it's bad, but Jesus will come who will put everything into right.
Yeah. light shines more in darkness.
Okay. I learned a lot.
It's good stuff.
Definitely.
Okay, so thank you so much, Jitesh. Thank you, Alvaro. Thank you, Sergio. Thank you for watching us today. And don't go anywhere, because I will be back after a very short break with today's conclusion and with a very interesting illustration. Let me share this final illustration with you. It's told a real story which happened in England. Mary and George got engaged, and soon George was commissioned to the army. They decided to get married when he came back from the war. Many days went by, letters would come, and then suddenly letters stopped coming. 1 week, 2 weeks, 3 weeks, many weeks. Finally, the commanding officer visited Mary and said that George was missing. This completely broke Mary's heart. Many months go by, and one day Mary comes home after work and, having told her mother that she's feeling under the weather, she asks her not to disturb her. She goes to her room, closes the door, gets all of George's letters, and the tears are running down her face when she thinks of him. Then she decides to make it even more real. So she takes George's picture and starts imagining herself as a bride. She even puts on the wedding dress, which she bought before George went to the war. She is so involved in this ritual that she doesn't hear the knock on the door downstairs. Her mother opens the door and almost faints. She says, "George, what are you doing here? You're supposed to be dead." He replies, "I'm all right. Is Mary married? Is she at home?" He walks in the house. Then he walks upstairs to Mary's room. He looks through the keyhole first. And in England at that time, the keyholes were so big that you could almost walk in through them. He says, "Mary," he sees actually Mary in the wedding dress, and then he gently opens the door and walks in. He touches Mary's shoulder, she turns around, and in a stage of a shock, she pronounces, "George." She wraps her arms around him, and then George dips his hand into his pocket, takes a piece of paper, and says, "Mary, dear, of all the letters you wrote to me, there is one that is the most precious to me. It says, 'Georgie, I love you, I love you, I love you. And when you come back, I'll be ready.'" He says, "Dear, I didn't know you would be so ready." We don't know when Jesus will come back again. But if we are ready today, we have nothing to be scared about. Until next week, stay connected with Jesus Christ in your everyday life and on Cross Connection.